Before we get started, I'm going to go through a couple background slides for those of you who are new to the Innovation Master Series sponsored by Imaginatic. Why do we do this? We do this because innovation is a young discipline, and those of you who are innovation practitioners know very well that there are no university degrees in innovation, and there are no very established professional organizations to help you foster your career as an innovation leader. And so in lieu of that, our goal is to help you have a forum to learn about the cutting edge of innovation best practices and how to be an innovation leader from others that are going through the same obstacles and struggles and challenges that you are. What does this all mean, and what is innovation leadership and innovation really about in the context of this webinar series? We believe and have seen that the 21st century is a different kind of place, and the way organizations need to function for success depends upon being able to respond and adapt to, and in many cases lead, change out there in the world. If you don't, we've seen the results of this, which is a lot of struggles. What you see here on this slide are some very high-profile examples of the kinds of problems that organizations can run into if you're not able to flex and adapt and change and respond. But of course, it doesn't necessarily mean bankruptcy. It can also be simply running into all kinds of operational or competitive problems. In any case, the age we live in now, we think of as the age of innovation, has become a major source of competitive advantage and often a major determinant of success for any organization, and therefore exists as a necessary capability beyond simply being operationally excellent, which of course in the 20th century was the primary driver of competitive advantage, differentiation, and success. This is clearly a trend that's not going away. We've seen studies that have shown that an increasing number or percentage of organizations now have dedicated innovation leaders. And we've seen in parallel through some of our own survey work that the robustness of the organizational footprint of innovation as a dedicated department or function or competence in the enterprise has been growing as well. If you are an innovation leader, like many of those who come to our webinars, you will know that helping to steward the practice of innovation inside your company is not easy work. And it's not easy for one reason, because your directives from above are often very unclear. So it's quite common that you will have a mandate for innovation, but not a clear definition of what that is, or an understanding from the C-level or the board of what it really means to be able to execute on that mandate, what kind of resources you need. And so you often find yourself having to define your own job and explain that to your superiors. At the same time, most organizations were built in a world of 20th century business when innovation was not as critical as it is today, and where the organization has become resistant or not so impervious to change. And as you start to remake an organization that can be more adaptive and change ready, you run into all kinds of pockets of resistance that manifest in a myriad different types of forms, such as those listed here. And for these reasons, inviting in a speaker like today's, Kurt Estes, is, we think, very important to give everyone the chance to hear from folks who have dealt with many of these problems, who have made headway in making their organizations more innovative, and hopefully can help impart some wisdom born out of that crucible of real-world experience to all the rest of you. Kurt Estes is someone that I had the pleasure of meeting for the first time this spring. Through some connections in the Chicago area. He has spent more than a decade as an innovation leader at Motorola, both on the venture and investing side and as an operational innovation leader like many of you on the call today. And Kurt has an interesting profile because he spans the gap between more traditional, somewhat more traditional, inorganic, venture-based innovation work, trying to bring innovation into the portfolio of the company from an incubation and investment perspective, and a really rich understanding of the operational side of innovation, of imbuing that into the culture and the operations of the company. So with a bit of understanding of one foot in each side of making a company really innovative, we thought it would be great to invite Kurt in and talk about his experience into what both makes corporate venturing really powerful and how that can connect to that deeper rhythm of innovation across the organization. With that, Kurt, I'd love to turn things over to you, and I'll be back when we have our first pause for questions. So, Kurt, I'm gonna turn over controls and welcome.
Okay, very good. Just waiting to see the...
Yeah, just 1 second.
So thank you, Chris, for the introduction. I very much appreciate it. Again, my name is Kurt Estes, and I'm with Sikich Investment Banking out of Chicago. And I'm very pleased to be here today to talk a little bit about some of my experiences in innovation, specifically focused on corporate venture capital and some of the challenges associated with that, but also some of the ways it can be a very good way to foster and accelerate innovation within a company. Quick disclaimer, please just take any information I give you today for informational purposes. I'm not trying to sell you anything. And if you do need to or would like to reach out to me, my contact information is also here. The simplest way is through email, which is kestes@sikich.com. Chris gave a little bit of my background. This is my bio. I have a background in engineering. While I was at Motorola, I did a lot of different types of innovation, starting in engineering through a tech shelf group and R&D, but also in intellectual property licensing, venture capital investment, internal business development, M&A, strategy, and then leaving Motorola Consulting, and now I'm in mergers and acquisitions advisor with an investment bank, which is its own form of innovation for a lot of different companies. So I'm on slide 4 now. Hopefully that's showing up for everybody. This is the question, why should a company innovate? And I think Chris's slide said it very well when he took a look at the slide that had Blockbuster, Kodak, and Borders going bankrupt. When you see companies like RIM struggling today, you see companies like Nokia having their issues, and even some of the issues that Motorola had at one point. At the end of the day, there's this very famous quote that a company that does not innovate to create new growth opportunities will be reduced to a purveyor of commodity products and services on its way to oblivion. And I say it's a very famous quote because it's one that I came up with. So that's my little plug today. But at the end of the day, I think we can all agree that innovation is very important to any growing company. And quite frankly, I would say to any company that wants to be around longer than the next few years. And innovation can be not just products and services, but also business models and practices as well. So people need to keep that in their head while they're thinking about innovation. I'm on slide 5, and this is a model that I was first introduced to by Gene Slawinski at a CoDev conference a number of years back. It's the Want, Find, Get, Manage, WFGM model, and they use it a lot for managing joint ventures, but I thought it was a very nice adaptation to thinking about innovation in general. And the thing I want to point out here is there's a lot of steps to innovation. But quite frankly, my belief, through my experience at Motorola, one of the most important things you can do is up front determine what are your goals for your innovation program. What are you trying to accomplish? What are you trying to get out of it? And then once you have that, then you can start to decide, how am I going to get there? Where do I find it? How do I get it once I found it? And how do I manage it? All those things are very important, but quite frankly, unless you know where you're going, you're never going to get there. Now, that's not to say that you need to set a goal and be myopic and never change that goal as the business environment necessitates change. All good business plans are changed periodically as more and more information comes available. But it's important to at least have a goal for what you're trying to do with innovation, which is essentially the point of this slide. On slide 6, we have what I like to call the three legs of innovation. We talk about internal programs like R&D labs, tech shelf groups, engineering staffs, employee ideation, and so forth. And you have the open innovation. I know open innovation was a big buzzword for a number of years in the early 2000s. And this is the things like licensing, working with national labs, customer input. I know Procter & Gamble was doing an awful lot of that for a while, university relationships, innovation brokers like Nine Sigma, who actually helped you to put your questions out there and get ideas back from a wide variety of innovators. That's what we call the open innovation leg. And then we have the third leg, which I call the inorganic leg. And this is companies acquiring innovation through M&A, working to create new innovative products and services through joint ventures with other companies. So it's very much an investment in an outside entity. And then what we're going to talk about today, and the focus of my discussion, is strategic venture capital investment. So actually taking minority equity position in what usually is early stage companies with very compelling technology that is in some way related to your innovation goals. So, definition, what is corporate venture capital? And essentially, it's making those minority investments in companies with an eye towards retaining or obtaining some sort of strategic benefit. It can't be all about, I'm investing a dollar so I get $1.50 back in financial return. Financial return is important, and for this I like to quote the founder of Motorola Ventures, Warren Holzberg, who once was asked, is Motorola Ventures, are you guys a strategic or a financial investor? And he said, well, we're absolutely a strategic investor, but losing money is not strategic. So what does that mean? It means every investment we made at Motorola, we were looking for the strategic connection. We were looking to have some sort of strategic value accrue from that investment. But we also were not stupid, and we did not throw money away by making investments in poor companies with bad business plans, regardless of the potential strategic return. This is just a quick listing of a lot of the benefits that can be derived from investing in venture capital. You obviously are going to get access to new technology. And a lot of times, companies will make venture investments for nothing more than to hedge their own R&D and to invest in disruptive technologies that they don't have the time or money to invest in within the organization. So a lot of times that is all they're really looking for. Obviously there is a good opportunity for financial returns if you do your venture investing correctly, but you can also get preferred pricing of the technology through licensing degrees. You get a very nice first look at companies that your company may want to acquire in the future. You also get access to new talent and access to new markets. Frankly, there's probably a number of other benefits here that we could talk about, but these are what I like to think of as the main benefits of corporate venture capital. Now, at this point, Chris, I'd like to just take a moment, pause, and see if there are any questions that I can answer before we move on to the next phase of the discussion.
Absolutely. Thanks, Kurt. So, as many of you know, we like to pause a couple times to take questions as they come through. For any of you that would like to ask Kurt a question about what you've seen so far, please type it into the questions module here in the GoToWebinar control panel. One question, Kurt, that's come in pretty interesting. Briefly, what do you think are the key differences between venture capital, VC, and corporate venture capital, CVC, especially in the types of companies they invest in?
Certainly. Well, in venture capital, it's always about making money. Venture capitalists raise money from a lot of different investors, and then they invest that money in startups in hope of having a big financial return. They really don't care about any kind of strategic benefit to anybody because, frankly, there is no strategic benefit to be had. Their investors are not strategic in nature, so there is no strategic interest at all in VC. Now, VC, you know, depending on the fund, they will invest in all kinds of different stages. They're very early stage to a very late stage. In corporate venture capital, pardon me, what you typically see are investments in what we like to call the B round and the C round. So not the earliest stage investments, but also not the latest stage. What you find in corporate venture capital is you can actually derive the most strategic benefit the earlier you invest in a company, long-term strategic benefit. But if you invest too early, you're going to have to wait an awful long time to see some of the more practical strategic returns like access to technology and so forth. So what you see is B and C level investments. And when I say B and C level, for those of you who don't know, in venture capital, when you're raising money for a company, the first round, the very first round is often called the seed or angel round. And the first institutional round where venture capitalists typically play is called the A round. and then you just kind of go alphabetically up, B, C, D, E, as many rounds of capital as you raise over the life of the company. So what I'm saying is you don't typically see corporate venture capitalists invest a lot of their money in the early stages, but also not in the very late stages, because quite frankly, in the very late stages, your ability to retain or obtain strategic rights is diminished because the company is further down the line in their life cycle. They've already created a lot of the relationships that you may have wanted to been a part of and so forth. And the strategic rights for very late stage investing are not as high as the earlier stages. Is that did I catch the spirit of the question in that, or is there?
Oh, yeah. I think that's great. I kind of want to get on to a couple of these others. There's actually some really good questions coming in. Let's see. So how do you negotiate what strategic investments the CVC program is making vis-a-vis what, say, internal R&D is working on, say, in their advanced projects wing? Are there synergies? Are there conflicts? Do you ever run into effectively, like, I suppose it's an innovation version of channel conflict?
Absolutely. In fact, it happens very often. A lot of times you're actually investing in technologies that are competing with stuff your internal teams are working on. And it really kind of depends on how you set up your venture investment arm. A lot of times companies will say, that's great because what we're doing is we're hedging our bet. We're developing our own technology, but in case ours loses in the marketplace, we've got access to this other technology. And again, it kind of gets back to how do you frame the goals and the strategy for going out and doing venture investing. Without a doubt, if you end up investing in technology that is competitive with internal, there's going to be people within your organization that are not going to be happy. But at the end of the day, that's why you need the high-level buy-in and direction from the highest levels on how they want to use their venture capital. And some companies just actually won't do it. They will not invest in something they're already working on inside. So it really kind of depends on how you set up the program.
Right, right. Okay, one more question for now, and then I think some of these other ones will probably start to be answered as we go along. Where in an organization does CVC typically sit? Who does it report to? What kinds of dotted line relationships does it usually have?
You know, every company's a little bit different. Within Motorola, we reported up, when I was there, reported up through the chief strategy officer. Later on, it ended up reporting to the chief financial officer. Some companies actually have a report to the CTO. And in others, even the CEO is the person that the organization reports to. So it kind of depends. Again, it comes back to when you're setting your goals for your organization, that will actually help you decide where to put it. If it's meant to augment your internal technology capability, it's probably going to be within the CTO organization. If it's meant to be more strategic and far-thinking and hedging and so forth, it probably won't be under the CTO because there'd be a conflict there. The CTO said, well, maybe I'm not going to be as eager to invest in these disruptive technologies or competing technologies, so you might want to have it within the chief strategy officer. I've even heard of, you know, organizations having it report to the head of mergers and acquisitions. And again, in that case, you might do that because your goal is to actually make minority investments in a lot of different companies that you think you may want to acquire in the future. So again, it kind of goes back to your company's culture and the goals you have for the organization you're creating.
Yeah, you know, it's really interesting because as many of you on the phone will see as we go through the presentation, there are so many parallels to what you might call organic or operational innovation inside the company, where it can report to many different senior leaders and have different types of goals, and therefore the structure and the mandate will change and flex quite a bit. And so there does end up being this, I suppose, somewhat kaleidoscopic range of reporting relationships and you know, paths to influence in the organization and so forth. Kurt, I'll give you back the floor. Let's keep things moving because I know there's a lot of great content. So back to you.
Okay. Very good. Yeah, just let me know how I'm doing on time. I know we spent the time on the questions, but hopefully it's all beneficial. Moving on to slide 9, this is simply meant to illustrate that at the end of the day, companies are actually starting to look to externally source R&D more and more, and part of that is through corporate venture capital. And in fact, there were recent studies that there's the CVC investment is starting to make a resurgence, and there's a lot of companies getting into corporate venture capital that were not there before. One thing that I found very, very interesting is the impact of a dollar of VC money invested, the impact on innovation versus a dollar invested in corporate R&D. You see the graph to the right, you see that the amount of innovation delivered through VC investment, dollar for dollar, is actually quite a bit higher in this one study than through corporate R&D. And you might think, well, why in the world would that be? And there are actually a number of reasons. One thing is an outside company has a lot less red tape, so they can actually get to market faster. And quite frankly, they have a focus on getting to market. Internal R&D has a focus on creating technology and making it the best technology they could possibly make. Outside R&D, a brand new startup outside of the company, what they're focused on is getting to market and making money. So good enough is good enough. A lot of times, especially when I was at Motorola, you found an R&D is, you know, it was never quite good enough. You put a bunch of super, super intelligent engineers into a lab and say, create new technology. They're going to create some amazing, amazing technology. But the problem is it may never get out of the lab because they just keep wanting to perfect it and perfect it and perfect it and never gets to market. And then finally, the last reason you might actually see greater bang for your buck investing in outside companies is the fact that when I'm investing in a brand new startup, say I put $1 million into that startup, chances are they're also raising $3 or $4 million from other investors at the same time. So my $1 million investment is actually going into a company to get another four from other people that'll be used, and all that money will be used to develop new technology and so forth. And if I've done my job correctly and I've created the right strategic relationships, I'm gonna have access to the technology being created using not just my money, but all the other people's money as well. So there is a big benefit to doing VC if it's done correctly. This is just a slide. Slide 10 is just a listing of a number of notable corporate venture capital programs. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail here, but there are a lot of companies that put a significant amount of money to work in venture capital. Frankly, some of those numbers might be a touch out of date, and the numbers might actually be a little bit larger, but I think those were accurate to 2012. So let's talk a little bit about obstacles to corporate venture capital. Why does it so often fail, as it has in the past? And the biggest number one reason is lack of commitment. At the end of the day, corporate venture capital is one of these things that takes a while to come to fruition and to start seeing the benefits from. Venture capital in general is a long-term investment. You have to make a commitment to investing for the long run. There's no liquidity, and your exits from your investments can be 5, 6, 7 years out. Similarly, you're doing strategic investing. A lot of times, there's not a lot of early benefit on the strategy side. Sometimes there is, but not always. The next most common obstacle is, at the end of the day, it's hard to hire people who have the capacity to do venture capital well within an organization. At the end of the day, people who are experienced venture capitalists are working for private funds because they pay a lot better, and they have what is essentially unlimited upside. If they have a huge win, they get what they call a piece of the carry, which is a piece of the profits of the investments they've made, and at the end of the day, it's essentially unlimited. There is no way most corporations are going to be able to hire managing directors and so forth into a venture capital organization that have the potential to make more than the CEO. It's just one of those things that's just not a good fit with most organizations. And so for that reason, a lot of times they cannot hire experienced people who understand venture capital investing into their internal group. What does this do? Well, at the end of the day, it's trial by fire. They hire people from within their organization who, on the good side, know about your organization and can help make the strategic relationships, but on the bad side, absolutely know nothing about venture capital investing. And let me be clear, venture capital investing is not M&A. So while there are some similarities, you can't just take a person who is adept at M&A and say, now you're doing venture capital investing, because there's a lot of differences and a lot of nuances, and it's just not the same thing. So you can't expect them to have those skill sets right away. So what happens is you hire these folks with no VC investment experience, and over the first couple of years, they make some pretty poor investments. Why? Because they don't know what they're doing really in minority investment in startups. And two, they don't have access to deal flow. At the end of the day, you can make better investments if you see more investment opportunities. And if you don't have that network, if you don't have the name out there, and people don't recognize you as an experienced VC, you're just not going to see the deals. So what happens is a lot of times these corporate venture groups have very poor results the first couple of years, and the senior leadership says, well, we can't do this, we're shutting it down. And that's why you have so many of them kind of flame out. However, if you look at the companies like Motorola and Intel, you know, these guys also had first year or two was not stellar years with respect to making great investments. But because the companies did not jettison those programs as soon as there was a little bit of a downturn, the people became very much more experienced in doing venture capital, and at some, and it, you know, year three, four, five, started making really, really nice investments with very good financial and strategic returns, and at the end of the day, became exceptionally successful venture capital programs in their own right. So there are a list of some other things on here. We've kind of touched on most of them, but that's, if there's anything to talk about, those are the two main hurdles for corporate venture capital success. This slide just shows you different ways that companies have approached doing venture capital investing. Some of them invest in outside funds. If you think, if you know anything about venture capital, you've heard of Kleiner Perkins, Excel Ventures, and so forth. And some companies will actually invest in outside funds like that. Now, these funds are financial investing funds, and the company invests in the fund thinking, well, it's going to give me a look at potential startups, but the truth of the matter is there's very, very little strategic benefit, and you get very little visibility into the companies that those funds are investing in. The good news is, you know, if you invest in an outside fund, you can have a very nice financial return. You know for a fact they're going to be managing the portfolio investments well. But you're not going to see any deal flow. You're not going to see any kind of improvement in your internal talent to do investments and create innovation. The next way a lot of companies do it is every business unit kind of makes their own ad hoc investments. You know, I'm doing this program and I'm working with that company, so as a business unit, I'm going to make a decision to take a 20% stake in this company over here that I'm working with. And that happened a lot at Motorola before Motorola Ventures was established. And what you end up having is a lot of orphans because you have all these business units making these random investments. Nobody is managing the portfolio. So you have diminishing financial return. You have diminishing strategic benefit because as one business unit relationship with an outside investment company goes away, there's no one to champion that relationship anymore, so the strategic relationship drops. Deal flow is ad hoc at best, and you really don't have any increase or accretion to your talent level at all. Then we have the internal corporate venture capital. Again, this is all about longevity. If you have the wherewithal to stick with the program, you will see very good strategic benefit from day one. Your financial returns will get better. Portfolio management starts out very good. Can deteriorate unless you have extreme focus on your group and you have continued commitment. And deal flow starts bad and gets good. Your talent starts out inexperienced and gets very, very good. Some of the best people I've ever worked with in venture capital were from corporate venture shops, but it's because they've been in it for a while and they knew what they were doing. And finally, I just want to put a quick plug in here. There are outsourced corporate venture capital models. Steamboat actually is Walt Disney's outsourced venture capital organization. Sikich has actually come up with a very innovative way to allow companies to outsource their venture capital function, allows you access to talent, deal flow, portfolio management, everything from day one, and a very close relationship with people who understand corporate venture capital and create strategic relationships, again, from day one. It's meant to be used by companies who are very interested in corporate venture capital, don't know how to start it, are a little worried about doing it inside, and would like to have experienced professionals delivering their, working on their corporate venture capital from day one. So that's the only plug I'm going to have today, guys, but there are some outsourced models. Now, I think it's time to stop for questions. Chris, do we have anything coming in?
Yeah, we do. A couple of interesting ones here. Let's see. Where, obviously there may be a range of answers, but who normally funds the investment options for a CVC? Where does the money come from? Where is the capital?
Usually it comes from the corporate office. Essentially, there's money set aside at the corporate level to do the venture investing. Now I'm talking about, of course, if these are company-wide centralized corporate venture capital organizations. I mean, I have dealt with companies before who've had a corporate venture organization that's just in one business unit, and in those cases, that money comes from that business unit. But usually, it comes from a corporate level.
Okay. Okay. That's good.
And it can be dedicated funds. It can say we're doing $20 million a year, we're doing $100 million a year, or it can be one of these things that says, you know what, we're not going to budget, but as you bring us good deals, we'll evaluate them, each one of them as they come, and invest in the ones we like, and with no upper or lower bound. So every corporation is a little bit different.
Right. Right. Of course. Yeah. In terms of, we talked a little bit before about potential conflict or some degree of conflict between internal R&D and venture investing. In cases where you have invested in a portfolio company and it's looking good, how do you or should you even create synergies internally and between this company or their technology and say what R&D inside your parent organization is doing? Like, you know, can you talk a little bit about how you gain acceptance for the venture portfolio and create synergies?
Yeah, absolutely. What I like to do, quite frankly, is unless it was a hedging investment where I was basically hedging a technology and investing in technology, knowing there was no near-term strategic benefit to the company, but it was something I was hedging against future technologies, except in those instances, I would try to create the strategic relationship before I made the investment and make sure that there was at least one or two organizations within the company that were very interested in technology, were talking to the people at the company I was investing in, and that we would have some strategic relationship in place or very nearly in place by the time I made the investment. That being said, once the investment's made, typically within the corporate venture capital organization, somebody owns that investment, and it's actually their job not only to look after the investment and monitor what the company's doing and what their financial performance is and where they are in their next raise and all that kind of stuff, but they're also there to kind of mediate and introduce within their own company to foster the strategic relationships. So all the time I was out talking with business leaders that I thought might be interested in companies I'd invested in and so forth, and trying to create meetings and synergies and so forth. But typically, I would try to set something up even before I made the investment. It just made your life a lot easier than trying to do it after the fact.
Yeah, that makes sense. Now you talked about the difference between an investment meant as a hedge between internal efforts and the external market, and deals where, on purpose, you meant it to be a strategic connection from the beginning. Do those two options fit into some larger portfolio that might be some kind of mandate for a CVC leader, as in, you know, these are the cases in which we plan to hedge, and these are the strategic drivers? Like, how would you construct the portfolio based on different models for the expected outcome?
Again, I would point this question back to the one find get manage model. It all comes with defining what are the goals of the venture organization. What do you want out of it? You know, some companies say all we want to do is hedge. We don't want any near term strategic. Because there's potential for conflict, we're not going to worry about that. We're only going to hedge against future technologies, be they competing technologies to what we're doing inside or tangent technologies that we think may become very important to our industry. And then they have other companies who say, all we want to do is near-term strategic. I'm not going to invest in anything where I don't have a licensing opportunity or a sell-through opportunity or something else. So you have kind of on either side. At the end of the day, at Motorola, we had a blended approach. I think we are weighted a little heavier towards more near-term strategic returns, but we did absolutely have, kind of the hedging strategy. And the other thing we had is we had the other type of investment where we were investing in companies that we weren't sure, but we thought we may want to acquire in the future as well. So that was kind of, I would say, almost a third type, where there may not be a very near-term strategic relationship, but it could be a business we want to get into. And so it's kind of a blend between what I would call the hedge and the near-term strategic. But again, it comes down to what are your goals, and every company can be a little bit different.
Yep. Okay. One more question here. There are a couple other questions, but I'm going to take one more and then just keep us moving. If you're the founder of a startup, what are the trade-offs that you should be thinking of between taking more traditional VC money versus CVC? When is it better? When is it worse, and why?
Well, frankly, I'm a little bit biased, and I think that the right corporate venture capital investor can do a lot more for you than a financial investor. Now, that being said, a lot of financial investors have very deep pockets. They also have a nice Rolodex and can make a lot of introductions and so forth. Frankly, if you're an early stage company, you take money from Kleiner, Perkins, that name carries a lot of weight, and frankly, you'll probably never have any issues raising money from other VCs at all, because I hate to say it, but a lot of VCs are very lemming-like in the way they approach things. And if you see a big name VC come into something, everybody wants to know about that company and potentially invest in it. Mm-hmm. On the strategic side, you know, obviously there's a lot of benefits. You have access to a very, recognizable brand. You have opportunity to potentially sell your products and services through the channels of the CVC. You may have opportunities to license technology from the parent company of the CVC, and there's an awful lot of opportunities to collaborate there. The downside with taking CVC money is, suppose I'm a startup and I took money from Motorola, and my technology had something to do with, say, phone software. Well, it may or may not make it harder for me to get in front of Nokia and make it harder for me to sell through Nokia. So there are those disadvantages as well. And so on a case-by-case basis, the entrepreneur needs to kind of weigh these things out and see what makes the most sense. At Motorola, we tried not to be too heavy-handed with our terms and our strategic relationship, because we didn't want to, well, we obviously liked the company, wanted it for ourselves and so forth. We didn't want to end up killing the company because we made it impossible for them to work with any other any of our competitors. But that is definitely a danger and something that a startup needs to keep in mind.
Very interesting. Thanks. Okay, to everyone there on the line who has not had your question answered, please bear with us. We'll try and get to as many as we can at the end. But for now, Kurt, why don't I toss it back to you?
Okay. Well, the next slide is meant to be just a listing of different ways that venture capital can actually impact your internal innovation. You know, different ways that you can actually foster innovation within your organization using venture capital. And I'm not going to go through all of these. I don't think we have the time for it, but I did want to focus in on the top right circle, the support or infuse of entrepreneurial culture. One of the things I noticed while I was at Motorola is oftentimes just exposing your internal people to the world of startups energized the organization and created what I would call a culture of entrepreneurship and so forth. I mean, what you find is a lot of people are working in these very large corporations. Many times have been there all their life, especially, and then if you get some of these guys in the labs and so forth, you know, they don't actually have the energy of a startup. And the only way you would know what I was talking about is if you've actually been around startups and you've been in larger organizations, there's just a different energy level. And what you find is by exposing your internal people to some of these startup organizations, that energy level is transferred, and you get a new sense of urgency, a new sense of excitement. You get new brainstorming and can, quite frankly, come up with new ways to do business. Chris, I know we talked about this at some length in a prior call, and one of the anecdotes, so we'll give you an example, and one of the anecdotes is a good friend of mine who was the chief information security officer at Motorola. I started working with him with some of the companies I invested in that did information security services. And through his work and exposure to those guys, he actually created a whole new business for Motorola where we were reselling the products and services of the companies we had invested in through Motorola Ventures. We were reselling those products and services to Motorola's suppliers and customers, as well as using their products and services inside of Motorola. So what does this do? Well, it gave us a brand new form of revenue at Motorola, but it also had the added benefit of making our partners' IT security much higher. And if you know, in a large corporation like organization like Motorola, there's a lot of IT links with our suppliers and so forth. So making them secure actually makes us more secure, and that also goes down the supply chain as well. So that's just one example of you know, infusing this entrepreneurial culture through your investments and exposure of your internal folks to your investment companies. So I'm going to kind of conclude here with four more slides. I'm going to give some examples of short-term, medium-term, and long-term impact. And when you're thinking about venture capital investment. So let's talk about making a venture investment that is directed at the business unit. And this would be investing in a company that has a very near-term strategic relationship opportunity with the business unit. At the end of the day, you have to have buy-in at the top. You don't want to circumvent the head of a business unit with some sort of investment and hope that they start working with the company. You really kind of have to get the people at the top, yes, I do want to work with that company, that outside company, because I believe their technology is important to my product, and therefore I want to work with them. At the same time, you want to identify key mid-level champions who are going to be kind of the day-to-day managers of that relationship. The VC, the corporate venture capitalist, is going to kind of foster a relationship and monitor it. But you have to have somebody within the business unit who's actually going to be doing the nuts and bolts and so forth and managing and helping the company that you've invested in work within the organization that the business unit that you're hoping to create a strategic relationship with. It makes sense to have regular review meetings with your business unit to understand their strategy so you can better identify potential investment opportunities and understand what they're looking for. This goes same thing with product development roadmaps. And it also is a good opportunity for the corporate venture capitalists to communicate to the people within the business units what they're seeing in the market in terms of new technologies and trends within the venture capital community. After you've made an investment, you definitely want to have standalone agreements, joint development agreement, a license agreement, a marketing agreement, and so forth, that define the relationship with the business unit. What's important here is the VC, the internal VC, should not be negotiating the agreements with the business units. These are agreements that need to be negotiated by the business unit, and they should be what we call standalone. They should pass the test that even if I didn't make the venture capital investment, this kind of agreement would still make sense for the startup company and the business unit. You can't have something where you tell the startup company that we'll invest in your company, but you have to give us a free license to all of your technology in perpetuity, because they would never do that were it not for the investment. You can get into some hot water doing things like that. That kind of thing happened a lot in the late 90s before the tech bubble blew. And there have since been regulations put in place to curb that type of activity. It's important for the venture capitalists to monitor the relationship and make sure both sides are communicating and act as a mediator whenever there are conflicts or issues that need to be resolved. Very similar for medium-term impact. This is where you're actually making investments and your company you're investing in is working with maybe an internal incubator or a tech shelf group or somebody who's creating kind of a new product and solution for your company, but it's not already productized. Again, you need to, before you start investing, you need to basically create a plan that identifies the relationship between your CVC organization and your internal incubator. You need to meet frequently, understand what each group is doing. What are the internal guys trying to create? What are the holes in their technology or service or product? And you kind of explain to them what you're seeing again in outside of the company. As the incubator internal is fostering and working on projects, you should really have project reviews and understand what they're doing. And then you should also review your portfolio. You know, take a look at all the different things the internal incubator is working in. Take a look at all the different investments you've made, see where there are connections, and where there are existing connections, you need to make sure you're keeping on top of that as well. Again, you come back to it makes an awful lot of sense to define the relationship between the portfolio company and the internal incubator. What's the plan going forward? Are there resources that are needed to be allocated? What are the specific goals for the two groups working together? And again, you have to have those internal key champions identified, who are the ownerships of the relationship on a day-to-day basis. Again, I can't say enough, communication is key. And I think this is something that's a common theme for all areas of innovation. If you're not constantly communicating with all of the interested parties, you're going to run into issues. And again, the corporate venture capitalist would act as a mediator between the incubator or the internal group within the organization and the external investment. On the longer term, again, this would be investing in future R&D or hedges. in this case, the example is working with R&D, understanding what they're trying to do, understanding their gaps, being mindful of confidentiality issues. Most venture capitalists, including corporate venture capitalists, won't sign NDAs up front because a lot of times they don't know what an outside organ, what everything that's going on inside their internal development groups. So you'll actually delay any kind of signing of an NDA until you have a very good understanding of what we're doing inside and what the outside company is doing, because you don't want to end up having some sort of legal conflict there where you have the big bad corporation thumping down on a little bitty startup. It's bad press and it can cause a lot of issues. You need to check where are the potentials for overlap, and where there are, you really need to define that relationship, define the intellectual property, where does ours end, where does theirs begin, where do we work together, and how do we own any kind of intellectual property coming out of this relationship going forward. All these things are very, very important. Once again, it all comes down to review, communication, and making sure you define your relationships at every level. Now, that being said, I've got the last slide of the day, well, except for, you know, except for the slide with that has some contact information. The last real slide of the day is talk about common themes within venture capital. Again, I think you're all going to recognize these as common themes for every type of innovation activity within an organization. Again, I've said it four or five times, constant communication is key, regardless of the level or who you're talking to. You need to have your senior folks within the organization understanding what the venture capital groups are doing, what the innovation groups are doing. You need to have the business units understand what you're doing. You need to have the companies you invest in understand what's going on within your company and make sure that they're communicating effectively to avoid any conflicts or misunderstandings. Said it once, and we'll say it again, high-level buy-in is critical. And I'm talking about board-level, CEO, CTO, CSO, CFO. The C-suite has to be bought into any kind of venture initiative within your organization. If they're not, you're not going to get the resources, you're not going to have the commitment, and quite frankly, you're probably going to fail. Working level champion, again, key in order to make sure you are getting the most out of your strategic investments. Like I said earlier, I always like to identify the strategic benefit and the strategic relationship before I made the investment. At the end of the day, it's very hard to make an investment and try to force that company's technology or innovative products down the throats of your business units. It's just, that's a losing battle. And at that point, that investment becomes more financial and less strategic. So I like to get that done early rather than late. We talked about how collaborating with venture stage organizations helps to create a sense of urgency and a kind of an entrepreneurial spirit and culture. I think that is one of the things that a lot of people don't realize when they're making venture investments, that it can do that, and it's actually one of the very large benefits you can get out of it. One thing I wanted to say here is you have to always remember that venture-backed startups have a very limited amount of resources, so you want to make sure that you don't abuse a relationship or ask more from them than they can reasonably deliver, because you have the very real possibility of killing the company you just invested in, so you have to be mindful of what it means to be a venture company, a venture stage company, what they can do and what they can't do. And the last thing I'd like to say is, you do get deal flow through your networks as a venture capital investor, and those networks are obviously external to your organization. You're meeting with the VCs out in the valley and VCs here and there to get deal flow. But quite frankly, you're also going to be able to source some very interesting opportunities from inside. A lot of times your people in R&D or in the business units are already working with early stage companies, and there are relationships that exist or are beginning, and some of those companies that they're talking to could be very interesting venture investment targets. So I would not neglect that channel either. So I know we've covered a lot. I know I speak very, very rapidly, but I did want to get to the point where I was able to convey all the information and still have time for questions. So I think we're at that point.
Thanks, Kurt. This is great stuff. I'm going to start off with a question really interesting about size and scale. So there's two parts. The first is, how large of a company do you have to be before creating a CVC fund and actually doing CVC investing in a dedicated way that makes sense? And then kind of as a corollary, how big does the fund need to be? I mean, if you only have $50 million to invest, is that just not enough? Or, you know, how big does it need to be?
Well, again, I think at the end of the day, if you're, if you don't have $50 million to invest, it's probably going to be marginalized. At the end of the day, you want to make sure through your investments you have a couple of things. You want to make sure you have a meaningful enough investment to secure strategic rights, so meaningful enough ownership in any company you invest in. You want to make sure you have enough money that if the companies you invest in need to do future rounds, you're going to be able to participate in those future rounds. And finally, you want to make sure you have enough money that you're going to be able to make more than one or two investments. At the end of the day, venture investing is always going to be risky. And the best way to minimize the financial risk is to create a portfolio of investments. So I like to think that, you know, a $50 million number is kind of what I would call the bare minimum for doing it and doing it right, unless you just want to invest at the extreme early stage and get companies when they're cheap, and then not worry so much about creating near-term strategic relationships. You know, 50 is about where I would say you need to be. So what does that mean in terms of the size of the corporation looking to do venture capital investing? Well, it kind of depends. How large do you need to be to have $50 million of cash you want to devote to this? That being said, you know, obviously if you saw the slides earlier, there's a lot of companies that invested significantly more money than that in their venture activities, many of them to great effect.
Let me ask kind of a related question, which is, I could imagine, a lot of this is speaking to, there's a couple of questions that are hinting at setting up a CVC organization in the first place, and what are some of the tensions and pressures, particularly at the high level, around doing that, that it could succeed or fail, that people understand it right or don't understand it right. Let's suppose that someone on this call who is an innovation or operational leader of some kind argues successfully with the CEO and or the board to start, you know, have their company start doing a CVC program, and it becomes some degree of public knowledge. So I could see one of two things happening. On the one side, that various departmental units, maybe especially in R&D or a line of business, would get very excited and come and start lobbying, hey, we really need to build this technology. We don't have the resources. Can we please use some of your portfolio? And so suddenly you're the, you know, the neighborhood kid that had a hit single on the radio, and suddenly everyone wants a piece of the action. On the other hand, maybe it would be seen as a threat, and you would actually see a lot of doors close in your face rather than everyone slamming down your own door. In your experience, where does the balance fall between those two? Is there kind of a third dynamic, and how do you negotiate the tensions therein?
That's actually a great question, and there is no easy answer. The truth is, if your organization is large enough, you're going to have people who resent what you're doing, and you're going to have people who love it to death and cannot wait to work with you and identify ways that you can help them. What you'll find a lot of times is that the hardcore R&D folks are going to be a little less enthusiastic about what you're doing because they see this as a threat to what they're doing. You know, we're creating the technology of the future, and you're saying you're investing in technology of the future outside of our company. Can't be as good, and quite frankly, you're potentially going to take food out of my kids' mouths, and I don't like you for it. And the business units are thinking, hey, you know what? I can see ways to enhance my relationship with some of my key partners by investing in them. A lot of times you'll see the business and say, this actually makes an awful lot of sense. Again, you're still going to have some tensions of, hey, why can't I do the investment myself? Why do I need some corporate centralized organization doing this for me? And quite frankly, there's a lot of reasons you do need a centralized approach that we can go into at a later date or on a separate call or something. But it really depends. You're going to see a wide range. I think in the day you definitely want, if you decide to do CVC, you want to make sure everybody knows you're doing it, internally and externally. Because at the end of the day, you're going to get the most opportunities for strategic relationships if your internal people know what you're doing, why you're doing it, and how you're doing it. And you're going to get the most opportunities to see good deal flow if outside people, the venture community and so forth, knows that you're making venture investments. So this is never something you want to keep quiet. If you decide to undertake a venture capital initiative within your organization, you want to make sure you broadcast it out so everybody knows what you're doing.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So maybe a related question. So one of our audience members is wondering about an anecdote or a success story that's representative of, say, your experience and your belief in when CVC works really well. And I guess I'd ask you if you can to frame it a bit, and this would be the sort of parting shot. So, you know, kind of take this however you think would be a good way to conclude. You know, a lot of the folks on the phone here are familiar with a lot of the challenges you've just made reference to, you know, but more on the where the tension between essentially being a threat to R&D potentially, and their side would be in-house, you know, incubated efforts rather than investing outside the company. You know, is there a story that kind of captures how some of the folks on the phone might work with someone like you when you were a CVC at Motorola to advance the mission or find common cause that helps embed both within the organization? Take that in whatever direction you want. I know that's pretty
fuzzy. That's a good question. That's a good question. And the truth is, it really comes down to understanding what's going on inside, understanding where the connection points are and the tension points are, and having an open dialogue and communication. At the end of the day, a lot of where you end up going is going to be dictated by the business units, because they're the ones that are going to be going to market with whatever technology or solution you come up with. So if they say, look, you know what, the stuff that the R&D group is doing is great, but this stuff that this company outside is doing is better or more mature or allows me to get to the market faster, chances are you're going to be going with the outside technology. So you just have to understand the dynamics within your own organization. There are various things we went through at Motorola, all kinds of different conflicts and so forth. I mean, probably the highest profile one was when Motorola invested in a company called Mesh Networks, which we eventually acquired. We had some competing technology, and at the end of the day, it ended up losing out to the mesh technology that we ended up acquiring, and that was one case. We also had some conflict with some of our ultra-wideband investments, and give me a second here. We had a wireless sensor network program that a company we invested in that competed with an internal program we had going on, and the eventual outcome of that was there were potential synergies of the two companies actually working together. It all comes down to communications and really understanding what's going on internally and what the connection points are and where the heads are of your business units and what their goals are and what they think. There's no easy answer. There really isn't.
Innovation is hard.
I think that goes without saying, yes.
Yeah, I'm sure there are lots of virtual head nods here. Well, Kurt, on behalf of the entire audience, thank you very much for being with us today. And to everyone on the other end, if you want to follow up with Kurt because your question didn't get answered or you'd like further dialogue, you can see contact information here. Of course, you can always get in touch with us here at Imaginetic, and we can hook you up with Kurt through that means. So this webinar is now finished. Stay tuned for more probably in the next month or two from us in the Innovation Master Series. And have a great day, everyone.
Thank you, everybody.